This is Guns and Butter. I'm Bonnie Faulkner. Today on Guns and Butter, the hidden history of Zionism with Ralph Schoenman.
And thanks to all of you, brothers and sisters, comrades and friends, for coming here for a discussion of an issue that has consumed people and yet suffers from the absence of real concrete data and information pertaining to the nature of Zionism, its origins, its character ideologically, its role historically, and precisely the political process through which Zionism has assumed hegemony in the Middle East, and to no small extent over the centers of imperial policy itself, notably since the events of 9/11. There have been four prevalent myths that have characterized our understanding of the nature of Zionism and of the Israeli state that is based upon it, and particularly in the United States and in Western Europe. The first myth pertains to the claim of a land without a people for a people without a land. The second myth is that of Israeli democracy. Virtually every newspaper and every television story and every reference to the Israeli state is prefaced by the claim that it is the only real democracy in the Middle East and so on. The third myth pertains to security as the motive force of Israeli foreign policy. Here you have a predatory colonial settler operation which has sought to destabilize each Arab nation in the region and to entrap it and ensnare it in conflict, the better to usurp more territory, presenting itself in a defensive posture. And perhaps the fourth and most prevalent myth has been that of Zionism as the moral legatee of the victims of the Holocaust. And what is particularly savage in the irony that surrounds this claim is the fact that the Zionist movement and the Zionist leaders itself were the active collaborators with the perpetrators of the Holocaust. They participated in the suppression of Jewish resistance, and they organized a consistent opposition to any escape on the part of European Jewry. The objective of Zionism has never merely been to colonize Palestine in the manner in which the colonial powers colonized Africa and Asia and, yes, Latin America. In the latter instance, the objective was to obtain resources and cheap labor in the process of imposing a colonial and imperial hegemony. But what distinguishes Zionism from other colonial movements is the relationship between the settlers and the people to be conquered. Because the avowed purpose of the Zionist movement was not merely to exploit the Palestinian people, but to disperse and to dispossess them. The intent was to replace the indigenous population with a new settler community, to eradicate the farmers, the artisans, and the town dwellers of Palestine, and to substitute a workforce composed of a settler population. And in denying the existence of the Palestinian people, the Zionist movement sought to create the political conditions for their removal, not merely from their land, but from history. When acknowledged at all, the Palestinians have been reinvented as a semi-savage nomadic remnant. Historic records have been falsified, a procedure that began during the last quarter of the 19th century, but continues to this very day. The Zionist movement would seek, throughout its inception, alternative imperial sponsors for this bloody enterprise. In fact, if you look carefully at the progenitors of Zionism, the upper layers of the haute bourgeoisie in Europe, their basic approach was to treat anti-Semitism as something not only endemic and inevitable, but also of considerable value. They despaired of any alternative to the anti-Semitic climate of the imperial regimes in which they subsisted. And they advocated making common cause with the anti-Semites for the purpose of converting the Jews of Europe into settlers afar. Herzl approached the most anti-Semitic and retrograde regimes of the day. They approached Count von Plehve of the Tsar, the author of the great pogrom at Kishinev and of the Black Hundreds. And they approached them with the proposition that if they funded and armed a Zionist movement to colonize Palestine, The Zionist movement would undertake that task on behalf of Tsarist imperialism representing its commercial interests in the area. And the same pitch was made to the Kaiser, who for over a decade armed and supported and dallied with the Zionist movement. The same approach made to the French Imperium and, of course, to the British Raj. So from its inception, Zionism has seen as its task enlisting the imperial powers, and indeed the most retrograde and anti-Semitic of them, as the fundamental political economic sponsors of the colonial enterprise itself. And this project embraced as well the fascism of Mussolini. It was Mussolini who funded the Zionist youth movement, particularly Beitar, whose leader was Menachem Begin, who wore the black shirt and gave the fascist salute, which they changed to the brown shirt with the advent of Hitler and Nazism in Europe. And the Zionist movement did not miss a beat with the advent of Nazism in Europe. On the contrary, the local Zionist organization of Germany expressed its open support for the Nazi Party and enlisted the Nazi Party as its sponsors. And the labor Zionists would bring Eichmann to Palestine in the 1930s, Baron von Mildenstein of the SS for a period of 6 months, leading to a 12-part series in the publication of the SS called Der Angriff, which means the assault, praising Zionism, with Heydrich and Himmler overseeing the stamping of a coin with the swastika on one side and the Star of David on the other, culminating indeed in the moment when the Zionist movement of Shamir made a formal military pact with the Wehrmacht, discovered in the German embassy in Ankara at the end of the Second World War and known as the Ankara document. So in understanding the particular political and ideological character of Zionism, both in relation to its victim people, the Palestinians, but notably in relation to the Jews themselves, we then come to comprehend the cruel irony of the ways in which the Zionist movement has wrapped itself in the collective shroud of the 6 million victims of the Holocaust, the better to visit upon itself a moral authority to impose on the Palestinian people a fate rather like that of the Jews in Europe. From its inception, every major spokesperson for the Zionist movement has set forth clearly what was intended in Palestine. It was nothing less than the systematic removal of the Palestinian people, their dispossession, and their elimination. In 1896, Theodor Herzl set forth his plan for inducing the Ottoman Empire to grant Palestine to the Zionist settler movement. If His Majesty the Sultan were to give us Palestine, we will undertake to regulate the finances of Turkey and form an outpost of civilization in opposition to barbarism, defending Turkish imperial and commercial interests in the region. Speaking at this Congress of the World Zionist Organization in 1905, the 7th World Zionist Congress, Max Nordau, a prominent Zionist leader, put forth before the Zionists themselves their concerns. There is a movement which has taken hold of a great part of the Arab people. It is taking a direction which will cause harm in Palestine. The Turkish government will feel itself compelled to defend its reign in Palestine and Syria with armed force. In these circumstances, we can persuade Turkey that they will require us to carry out their particular operations, a strong, well-organized, relentless military group which will suppress this population and eliminate it. The South African connection is a very old one. It does not merely encompass Prime Minister General Jan Smuts, who is a South African delegate to the British War Cabinet, pushed the British government to adopt the Balfour Declaration, making a commitment to construct a Zionist colony under British direction. The relationship between Zionism and the South African settlers had evolved much earlier, because the settlers played a similar role in South Africa as they would in Palestine. N. Kirshner, the chairman of the South African Zionist Federation, provided a vivid account of the intimate interaction between the Zionists and South African leaders, the identification of Zionists like Weizmann and Herzl with the South African conception of a racially distinct colonizing population. As to Theodor Herzl, the founder of political Zionism, he expressed his fundamental commitment and his modeling of the Zionist program on that quintessential colonial ideologue, Sir Cecil Rhodes. As Herzl wrote about Rhodes, there are differences between Cecil Rhodes and my humble self, all to my disfavor, to my very great personal disfavor. The objective ones are in favor of our Zionist movement. We will only accomplish the Zionist dispersal of the Palestinians by using the methods pioneered by Rhodes. The Jewish company will be modeled on the colonial chartered company of Rhodes, and it will be a great acquisition company that will carry out its task through military and commercial means. The poorest will first go to cultivate the soil. In accordance with a preconceived land plan, they will construct roads and bridges and railways and telegraphs and regulate rivers and build their own habitations and drive the indigenous population out. One of the ideological forebears of Zionism, Vladimir Jabotinsky, is known as the founder of revisionist Zionism, that Zionist current which had little patience with the liberal and socialist facade employed by labor Zionists. In 1923, Jabotinsky wrote The Iron Wall, which is a benchmark essay for the entire Zionist movement, in which he sets forth bluntly and clearly the premises of Zionism. They had indeed been laid out in the diaries of Theodor Herzl and in the political writings of Chaim Weizmann, if not as eloquently as the declaration of Jabotinsky, known as the Iron Wall. There can be no discussion of reconciliation between us and Palestinian Arabs, not now, not in the future. All well-meaning people, with the exception of those blind from birth, have understood long ago the complete and utter impossibility at arriving at agreements with the Arabs of Palestine for the transformation of Palestine from an Arab country to a country under utter control of Jews. Each of you has some general understanding of the history of colonization. Try to find even one example when the colonization of a country takes place with the agreement of the native population. Such an event has never occurred. The natives will always struggle obstinately against colonists, and it is all the same whether they are cultured or uncultured. The comrades in arms of Hernan Cortes and Francisco Pizarro conducted themselves like brigands. The Redskins fought with uncompromising fervor against both evil and so-called good-hearted colonizers. The natives will struggle against any form, any kind of colonization, anywhere and at any time, because it is inadmissible to them. Any native people views their country as their national home, of which they will be masters, and they will never voluntarily allow a new master who drives them out. So it is for the Arabs. Compromisers among us try to convince us that Palestinians are some kind of fools who can be tricked with hidden formulations of our basic goals. I flatly refuse to accede to this view of the Palestinian Arabs. They have the precise psychology that any oppressed people has. They look upon Palestine with the same instinctive love and true fervor that any Aztec look upon his Mexico or any Sioux upon his prairie. This people will struggle against colonizers until the last spark of hope that they can avoid the dangers of conquest and colonization is extinguished. Yes, the Palestinians will struggle in this way until we have removed the last spark of hope. It matters not what words we use to explain our colonization. Colonization has an integral, inescapable meaning. It is understood by every Jew and by every Arab. We have but one goal. It is in the nature of things. We shall carry on this colonization against the will of the Palestinian Arabs. That condition exists now. It will subsist in the future, and we will never relinquish it. And even an agreement with non-Palestinians represents the same kind of fantasy. For in order for genuine Arab nationalists of Baghdad and Mecca and Damascus to agree to pay so serious a price, they would have to abandon the Arab character of Palestine. For we shall not give compensation for Palestine neither to Palestinians or to other Arabs. A voluntary agreement is inconceivable. Let us be clear about that. Even the most restricted colonization would only be possible in defiance of the will of the native populace. Ours will continue to develop only under a shield of force, which comprises an iron wall through which this people will never break through. This is our Arab policy. To formulate it any other way is hypocrisy. Whether through the Balfour Declaration or the mandate, external force is the necessity for establishing in this country conditions of rule through which this people, regardless of its wishes, will be deprived of all possible physical and administrative means of impeding us. Force, relentless force, will play its role without indulgence. And in this, let us be clear, there is no meaningful difference between our militarists and our vegetarians. One prefers an iron wall of Jewish bayonets, the other an iron wall of English bayonets. And to the hackneyed reproach that this point of view is unethical, we say untrue. This is our ethic. There is no other ethic. As long as there remains the faintest spark of hope for Palestinians to impede us, they will not sell these hopes, not for any sweet words nor for any tasty moral, because this is not a rabble, but a people, a living people. And no people makes such enormous concessions on such fateful questions of existence, except when there is no hope left, until we have removed any remnant, every opening visible in the Iron Wall. The colonization of Palestine has been punctuated by periodic massacre from one end of that country to the other. It is the means through which Palestine was emptied of its population. Now, we should bear in mind that in 1947, there were now 600,000 settlers and 1.4 million Palestinian Arabs. At the time of the partitioning of Palestine over the heads of the Palestinian people in 1947, the settler population were 27% of the populace. The United Nations heard before the Select Committee on Palestine the testimony of Rabbi Fishman on behalf of the Jewish Agency. And Rabbi Fishman presented a map based upon the diaries of Theodor Herzl, page 711 of volume 2 of the Complete Diaries of Theodor Herzl, which declared that the area of Eretz Israel of the Jewish state stretched from the brook of Egypt to the Euphrates. And that map, which was presented to the United Nations as to what constituted Eretz Israel, included all of Palestine, all of Transjordan, Egypt up to the Nile, including Cairo, one-third of Arabia, two-thirds of Syria, 40% of Iraq, and the southern tier of Turkey, right, indeed, extending up to and encompassing Kuwait. Eretz Israel, 1947, formally presented on behalf of the Jewish Agency for Palestine before the United Nations Special Committee on Inquiry on July 9, 1947. They awarded the Zionist movement 55% of the most fertile land. Within days, and indeed weeks, the process of eliminating the population of Palestine was unfolding. The Judaizing of the land, the seizure of the land. And I think it's essential that we also bear in mind that all of the major spokespersons of the Zionist movement had proclaimed this as their essential objective. In 1940, Joseph Weitz, the head of the Jewish Agency's Colonization Department under David Ben-Gurion, responsible for the organization of settlement in Palestine, wrote, "Between ourselves, let us be clear, there is no room for Palestinians in this country. We shall not achieve our objective if they are allowed to remain. There will be no other way. We will transfer them, all of them, not one village, not one tribe, not one clan shall be left." As for Ben-Gurion and the labor Zionists, in a speech to the Zionist meeting on October 13, 1936, Ben-Gurion said, "We do not suggest that we have renounced our ultimate aim, which is far-reaching, far more than the revisionists who oppose partition. The final vision, an organic, spiritual, ideological component of my Zionist aspirations, is clear. It is the elimination of the Palestinian population." And in the same year, Ben-Gurion, in a letter to his son, "A partial Jewish state is not the end, it is only the beginning. We cannot be prevented from settling in all parts of that region." In 1937, "The boundaries of Zionist aspiration are the concern of the Jews alone, and no external factor will limit us. By 1938, Ben-Gurion is explicit. The boundaries of Zionist aspiration, he told the World Council of Poel Zion in Zion in Tel Aviv, include, in the first instance, southern Lebanon, southern Syria, today's Jordan, all of Cisjordan, and the Sinai. He formulated, did Ben-Gurion, Zionist strategy very clearly. When we've become the dominant force as the result of the creation of the state, we shall abolish this partition and expand to the whole of Palestine, and that is but a stage in the realization of Zionism. Its task is to prepare the ground now for our expansion. This state will preserve its order not by preaching, but with machine guns. By May of 1948, here is Ben-Gurion to the General Staff. Prepare to go over to the defensive. Smash Lebanon, Transjordan, and Syria. The weak point is Lebanon. This regime is artificial. It will be easy for us to undermine it. We shall establish a puppet Christian state there, and then we shall smash the Arab legions, eliminate Transjordan. Syria will fall to us. We then bomb and move on. We take Port Said, Alexandria, and the Sinai. And when General Yigal Alon asked Ben-Gurion, well, what do we do with the population of Lida and Ramla, 50,000 inhabitants? Ben-Gurion, as his biographer describes, waved his hand and said, you know what to do, drive them out. Every major spokesperson, there is nothing obscure, concealed, or unstated about the Zionist record of liquidation. The Koenig Report. We will use terror, assassination, intimidation, land confiscation, the cutting of all social services to rid the Galilee of its Arab populace. Chairman Heilbrun of the Committee for the Re-election of General Shlomo Lahat, the mayor of Tel Aviv. We shall kill all the Palestinians unless they are resigned to live here as slaves. And here are the words of Yuri Lubrani, David Ben-Gurion's special advisor in Arab affairs in 1960. We shall reduce the Palestinian population to a community of woodcutters and waiters. And Raphael Eitan, the chief of staff of Israel's armed forces, we declare openly that Palestinian Arabs have no right to settle on even one centimeter of Eretz Israel. You good souls should know that the gas chambers of Adolf Hitler will be as a recreational palace. Force is all they do or ever will understand, and we shall use the ultimate force until the Palestinians come crawling to us on all fours. Eitan elaborated before the Knesset's Foreign Affairs and Defense Committee a formal declaration. When we have settled this land, all the Arabs will be able to do is scurry around like drugged roaches in a bottle. Well, then, how did they go about it, and what did they do? The process, as I said, was one of sustained slaughter. Village after village was wiped out. The killing was intended to cause people to flee for their lives. The commander of the Haganah, Zvi Ankori, described it in detail. We oversaw cut-off genitalia, women's crushed stomachs. It was direct murder. Menachem Begin would gloat over the impact throughout Palestine of the Nazi-like operations that he commanded at Deir Yassin. A legend of terror spread amongst Arabs who were seized with panic at the mere mention of our soldiers. It was worth dozens of battalions to our forces. Palestinians throughout the country were seized with limitless panic and fled for their lives. This mass flight developed into a maddened, uncontrollable stampede. Of the 800,000 Arabs who lived on the present territory of Israel, only 165,000 are still there. The political and economic significance of this achievement can hardly be overestimated. Here is an eyewitness account of this process. This is, by the way, by Red Cross personnel. It was noon when the battles had ended and the shooting stopped. Things had become quiet, but the villages had not surrendered. The Zionist soldiers left the places in which they had been hiding and now carried out cleaning up operations. They fired with all arms they had. They threw explosives into buildings. They shot everyone they saw, women and children. The commanders made no attempt to check the disgraceful slaughter. I myself and a number of our personnel begged the commanders to give orders to their men to stop, but these were unsuccessful. People were brought out of their houses. They were loaded into freight trucks and led in a victory parade like a Roman triumph through to Machane Yehuda and Zichron Yosef in Jerusalem. They were then taken to the stone quarry between Givat Shaul and Deir Yassin and shot in cold blood. The women and children who were alive still were taken on trucks, taken out to the Mandelbaum gate, and shot there. The director of the International Red Cross in Palestine, Jacques de Renier, then attempted to intervene as word of the slaughter spread as it was unfolding in village after village. The commanders would not receive me. At last, one of them arrived, young, distinguished, and perfectly correct, with a peculiar glitter in his eyes, cold and cruel. According to him, the Haganah had arrived and had ordered inhabitants by loudspeaker to evacuate their houses. Some of these miserable people came forward, and we dealt with them as was their deserts. There's no point in exaggerating things. You will find the dead, and they will be buried as soon as the cleanup is finished. The accounts made my blood run cold. I went back to the Jerusalem road, got ambulances and trucks. I alerted the Red Shield. I tried to reach villages by convoy to alert them. The gangs of Haganah were wearing uniforms with helmets, young adolescents, men, women armed to the teeth, revolvers, machine guns, hand grenades, cutlasses in their hands, blood-stained. A beautiful young girl with criminal eyes showing me hers, dripping with blood, displaying it like a trophy. This was their cleanup team, and they were performing their task conscientiously. I tried to go into houses. Dozens of soldiers surrounded me, their machine guns aimed at my body, their officers forbidding me to move. I flew into one of the most towering rages of my life, telling these criminals what I thought of their conduct, threatening them everything I could think of, and then pushed them aside and went into the houses. There was darkness, everything in disorder, disemboweled furniture. I found the bodies cold. The cleanup had been done with knives. Anyone could see that. I looked everywhere, turned over all the bodies. I found a little foot still warm, a little girl of 10, mutilated but still alive. Everywhere, the same horrible sign, village after village. All had been massacred in cold blood. For as I observed for myself, this gang was admirably disciplined and acting under orders. And his detailed account continues for pages. Here is the account in Davar, the official Hebrew daily newspaper of the labor Zionist-run Histadrut, General Federation of Workers. This is the fate of the population of Douema. They killed hundreds of Arab men, women, and children. To kill the children, they fractured their heads with sticks. There was not one home without corpses. The men and women of the villages were pushed into houses without food or water. And then the soldiers came to dynamite them. Commander had ordered soldiers to bring women into buildings they were about to blow up. Soldiers prided themselves on raping the Palestinian women before shooting them to death. Palestinian women with their newborn children were made to clean the place for days, and then they were shot in the infants. Educated, well-mannered commanders, who were considered good guys, became base murderers, and this not in the storm of battle, but as a method of expulsion and extermination. Our orders were, the fewer the Arabs who remain, the better. This program of massacre continued from one end of Palestine to the other for the next 10 years, through Gaza, from Khalil to al-Jalil, village after village, town after town. Kfar Qasim, the massacre at Kfar Qasim followed the Zionist pattern. October 1956, Israeli Brigadier Shadmi, the commander of the battalion on the Israeli-Jordanian border, ordered curfews imposed on the minority Palestinian villages. These villages were inside the Israeli borders. Their inhabitants were considered citizens. The commander of the unit, Major Malinki, was told that a curfew must be extremely strict. Any who broke it would be shot on the spot. Indeed, they were not to be informed of the curfew. He, Malinki, passed the curfew throughout the villages. Anyone leaving their home, anyone breaking the curfew, would be shot dead. There would be no arrests. If people were killed in the night, this would facilitate the imposition of the curfew on succeeding nights. Lieutenant Frankenthal asked, "What do we do with the wounded?" Malinki replied, "Take no notice of them." The section leader asked, "What about the women and children?" Malinki replied, "No sentimentality." When asked, "What about people returning from their work?" "It's too bad about them." The perpetrators of the Kfar Qasim massacre, which was a commando unit of Ariel Sharon's Commando Unit 101, were all rewarded with medals and with promotions in the Israeli armed forces. It is through this process that over 485 villages and towns were seized and emptied of their population and the land confiscated. Of 475 towns and villages, 385 were reduced to rubble and wiped off the map. Moshe Dayan was uninhibited in his summary of this process in his speech before the students at the Israel Institute of Technology, the Technion. We came to a country populated by Arabs, and we are constructing here a Jewish state. Instead of Palestinian villages, Jewish villages have been established. You do not even know the names of these villages, and I do not blame you, because these geography books no longer exist. Not only the books, but also the villages do not exist. Nahala was established in place of Mahalul, Gavat in place of Jibra, Sarid in the place of Hanifas, Kfar Yenashua in place of Tal Shaman. There is not a single settlement that was not established in the place of a former Arab village. And with the expulsion of the Palestinians and the destruction of their towns and villages, vast amounts of property were now seized under the rubric of the absentee property law. Indeed, legislation was passed based upon the Jewish National Fund, which made it a requirement that in order to own land, to lease it, to rent it, to live on it, you had to prove at least four generations of maternal Jewish descent. This is the process through which Palestine was emptied of its population. This is the modality through which the apartheid state of Israel established itself. Consider that in the United States or in any other country, in order to have the right to live on land, to lease it, to rent it, you had to show you had no Jewish blood for at least four generations. Who would doubt the quintessential nature and racist character of a regime predicated upon this set of legislation and this institutional character? So indeed, Zionism has as its particular feature the task and the project of eliminating the Palestinian people from history, removing their organized existence, pursuing them in whatever location to which they have fled. The inhabitants of the Galilee, of Jalil, who were driven out, settled in the refugee camps in Lebanon. For the first 15 years, they were not allowed to build permanent structures. Only after that time were they allowed to use cinder block. The largest of these camps in Ain el-Hilla, outside of Saida. You may remember in 1982, with the Third War to seize and control Lebanon, it was launched in the name of Peace in the Galilee. Cruel irony. For the actual inhabitants of the Galilee were in the refugee camps in Lebanon. And indeed, in Ain el-Hilla, they had organized their communities on the basis of the villages from which they had been driven out. Some 85,000 people in Ain el-Hilla. Ain el-Hilla was taken as a grid. It was bombed, saturation bombed systematically, quadrant by quadrant, for 10 days and 10 nights, unrelenting. At the end of the bombardment, it was shelled by artillery from the sea. At the end of this artillery bombardment, and Maya and I were living in Ain el-Hilla, the Zionist militia and the Zionist army came with its bulldozers. They leveled everything. They bulldozed over the shelters in which people were sheltering and were buried thus alive, with family members clinging to the bulldozers to prevent the occurrence. What would be replicated in Jenin and throughout the West Bank was the precise modality through which all of Palestine was emptied of its population. That is the legacy, that is the nature, that is the character of the Zionist state, that is the means through which the removal of the population was accomplished, that is the objective of the state when it declares itself an exclusively Jewish state. Judaizing the land means removing the Palestinian people from history. And all that is unfolded in the West Bank and Gaza is but the little continuation of the process through which all of Palestine was colonized. Indeed, what of the relationship which I began to discuss of Zionism to the Jews? Herzl. The Jewish people is a very bad people, its neighbors hated and rightly so. Its only salvation lies in the colonization of the land. Hashemir Hatzair. A Jew is a caricature of a normal, natural human being, both physically and spiritually. As an individual in society, he revolts and throws off the harness of social obligation. He knows no order, no discipline. Herzl. I have achieved the free attitude towards anti-Semitism, which I not only understand historically, but pardon. I recognize the emptiness and futility of attempting to combat anti-Semitism. And so he writes to Count von Plehve with the following proposition, quote, help me to reach the land, and we will end the revolt against Tsar's rule. We shall remove for you these anarcho-Bolshevik subversive Jews. Von Plehve. We will finance the Zionist movement. Your Jews, however, are joining the revolutionary parties. We support your Zionist movement. You don't have to justify this movement to me. It is consonant with our own. You are preaching to a convert.
You're listening to The Hidden History of Zionism with Ralph Schoenman. I'm Bonnie Faulkner. This is Guns and Butter.
The Zionist Federation of Germany. Its memorandum of support to the Nazi Party on June 21, 1933. A rebirth of national life such as occurring in German life will also take place in the Jewish national group. On the foundation of the new National Socialist State, which has established the principle of race, we wish our community to fit into total structure so that for us too, in the sphere assigned to us, we shall work fruitfully for the fatherland. Indeed, the Jewish organizations and the Jewish leaders throughout Europe at the time of the rise to power of Adolf Hitler, which occurred at the time of the Great Depression when marks were being carried around in wheelbarrows, attempted to organize a boycott of Nazi goods and Nazi production. That boycott was broken by the World Zionist Congress, which set up the Havara to market Nazi goods throughout the Middle East and Northern Europe. From the inception, the Zionists were in collusion. In 1937, the Labor Socialist Zionist Militia, the Haganah, sent 5 Opolkas to Berlin to offer their services to the SS security services. Adolf Eichmann was invited to Palestine as the guest of the Haganah. 5 Opolkas to Eichmann. Jewish nationalist circles are very pleased with the radical German policy, since the strength of the Jewish population in Palestine will be so far increased that in the foreseeable future we can reckon upon numerical superiority and domination over the Arabs. Ben-Gurion, to a meeting of labor Zionists in Great Britain in 1938. If I knew that it were possible to save all the children in Germany by bringing them out, but only a handful by transporting them as colonists to Eretz Israel, we opt for the second alternative. Beryl Katznelson, editor of the labor Zionist Davar, describing, quote, the cruel criteria of Zionism, unquote. These German Jews are too old to bear children in Palestine. They are not Zionists. We need colonists, trained, armed colonists, supported by the regimes themselves. As late as 1943, while the Jews of Europe were being exterminated in their millions, the United States Congress proposed to set up a commission to study the problem. Rabbi Stephen Weiss, the principal spokesperson for Zionism, went to Washington to testify against any rescue bill, any reduction in quotas, any allowance of immigration to the United States, to Great Britain, to Canada, to Australia, because it will divert attention from our colonization of Palestine. Yitzhak Grunbaum, the chairperson of the Zionist Committee, set up to investigate the condition of European Jews. When they come to us with a plan to rescue the masses of Jews in Europe or the redemption of the land without a second thought, we support the redemption of the land. The more said about the slaughter of these people in Europe, the greater the minimization of our attempts to promote the Hebraization of the land. If there were the possibility of today of buying arms with the money of the Keren HaSayed, the United Jewish Appeal, and send it to Palestine, as opposed to sending aid to the Jews of Europe, would we do the latter? No, and once again, no. In July 1944, the Slovakian Jewish leader, Rabbi Dov Michael Weiss Mandel, in a letter to Zionist officials charged with, quote, rescue organizations, he had provided them with exact mapping of the railways and appealed for the bombing of the tracks on which the Hungarian Jews were being transported to the crematoria. He appealed for the bombing of the furnaces at Auschwitz, for the parachuting of ammunition to 80,000 prisoners, for the parachute of saboteurs to blow up the means of annihilation, to end the cremation of what he described as 130,000 Jews a day. Weissmandl was not alone. Throughout the 30s and 40s, Jewish spokespersons in Europe cried out for help, for public campaigns, for organized resistance, for demonstrations to force the hand of the Allied governments. They were met not merely by Zionist silence, but by active Zionist sabotage. Here is the Creed de Coeur of Rabbi Weissmandl, writing to the Zionists in July 1944. Why have you done nothing until now? Who is guilty of this frightful betrayal? Are you not guilty, you who have the greatest good fortune in the world, your liberty? We send you this special message to inform you that yesterday the Germans began the deportation of Jews from Hungary. The deported go to Auschwitz to be put to death by cyanide gas. Here is the schedule of Auschwitz from yesterday to the end. 12,000 Jews, men, women, and children, old men, infants, healthy and sick, are to be suffocated daily. And you, our Zionist brothers, you ministers of all the kingdoms, how you keep silent in the face of this great murder. Silent you are, our thousands upon thousands, reaching now to 6 million, are murdered, and silent now while tens of thousands are being murdered and waiting to be murdered. Their destroyed hearts cry out to you for help as they bewail your cruelty. Brutal you are, and murderous too you are, because of the cold-bloodedness of the silence in which you watch, because you sit with folded arms and do nothing. Although you could stop and delay the murder of these Jews at this very hour, you, sons of Israel, are you insane? Don't you know the hell around us? For whom are you using this money, you murderers, you madmen? Who is it gives charity? You who toss a few pennies from your safe homes while you conspire against us, or we who give our blood in the depths of hell? The Holocaust? The culmination of Zionist betrayal was the sacrifice of Hungary's Jews in a series of agreements between the Zionist movement and Nazi Germany, which first became known in 1953. Dr. Rudolf Kastner of the Jewish Agency Committee in Budapest, under the directions of Ben-Gurion, signed a secret pact of Adolf Eichmann to, quote, settle the Jewish question in Hungary. This took place in 1944, and the pact sealed the fate of 800,000 Jews. Kastner was under the direction of the Zionist leaders when he made his agreement with Eichmann, and the quid pro quo was 600 prominent Zionist leaders who were to be transported out. When a survivor, Malchiel Greenwald, exposed the pact and denounced Kastner as a collaborator whose, quote, deeds in Budapest under Zionist direction cost the lives of hundreds of thousands of Jews, he was sued by the Israeli government. And even the Israeli Supreme Court came to the conclusion the sacrifice of Hungarian Jews in order to secure the prominence was the basic element of the agreement between Kastner and the Nazis. They fixed the division of the nation into a small fragment of prominent Zionist leaders, and on the other hand, the great majority of Hungarian Jews designated for death. The Zionist collaborators kept secret the plans of extermination, betrayed the leaders of the resistance, colluded in the transportation vehicles themselves, participated fully in the entire process of deportation. That is the record of the relation of Zionism to the Jews. Zionism's perfidy, The betrayal of the victims of the Holocaust is but the culmination of their attempt to identify the interests of the Jews of Europe with those of the established order. They made their pact with the most retrograde and imperial regimes of the day. And indeed, the most remarkable declaration of all can be found in Vladimir Jabotinsky's final work, The Jewish War Front. He wrote of his plans for the Palestinian people. Since we have now obtained this moral authority for calmly envisaging the exodus of Palestinians, we need not regard their forced departure of 900,000 with dismay. Herr Hitler has been enhancing the popularity of population transfer. This remarkable declaration in the Jewish War Front synthesizes Zionist thought and its moral bankruptcy. The slaughter of the Jews gave Zionism a great moral authority. For what? For calmly envisaging the exodus of Palestinians. The lesson of Nazi destruction of the Jews was that it was permissible now for the Zionists to visit the same fate upon the entire Palestinian population. And 7 years later, the Zionists emulated the Nazi genocide whose backing they sought and achieved, and they covered bleeding Palestine in a multiple of liturgies, driving 850,000 people into exile. That is the legacy, that is reality, that is the character of the Zionist state, that is the meaning of the policies in the West Bank and Gaza, that is the logic of Jenin, that is the meaning of the wall, that is why the Wehrmacht plan, the literal Wehrmacht plan for the Warsaw Ghetto, is the model studied by the Israeli Armed Forces commanders, not only for the construction of the wall in the West Bank today, but as the Wehrmacht plan for the destruction of the uprising of the Warsaw Ghetto, which served as the model for the destruction of Jenin, of Nablus, and the old quarter, the thousand-year-old old quarter of Nablus that was leveled to the ground. It is the model, indeed, for Sabra and Shatila. It was the model for the mass graves that are to be found all over Lebanon. The mass grave in Ain El Helway, in Rosh Hadia, in Al Bas, in Burj Al Baraji. After the Israeli occupation in Lebanon, the mass graves in Ain El Helway were such that the body fluids surfaced to the ground and formed a small river. And the International Committee of the Red Cross building was in the path of this river of body fluids of the mass graves of the massacred. So they moved their building so as not to be in the path of the rivulets of body fluids of the massacred of Ain El Helway. And you will find nary a report in the International Committee of the Red Cross of the systematic massacre of the Palestinian population, the refugee population, the victim population, the population, the survivors of the massacres of 1948 to 1955 in Palestine. Let us understand the basic elements of the construction of the State of Israel. Between 1948 and 1953, 370 Jewish towns and settlements were established. 350 were on so-called absentee property. By 1954, 45% of Israel's Jews lived on property confiscated from absentees. 250,000 new immigrants settled in urban areas from which Palestinians had been expelled through massacre. Entire cities had been emptied of their population. Jaffa, Acre, Lydda, Ramla, Bisan, Majdal. The plunder embraced 385 towns and villages in their entireties and large sections of 94 other cities and towns containing 35% of all buildings in Israel. 10,000 business and retail stores were handed over to settlers. From 1948 to 1953, the period of greatest immigration, the economic importance to Israel of seized Arab property was decisive. The amount of cultivatable land seized from Palestinians driven from the country by massacre was 3.5 times the total area of the land granted the Zionists with the end of the mandate. All citrus groves of Palestine were seized. 450,000 dunams. By 1951, 2.5 million boxes of citrus from seized Arab groves were in Israeli hands, 20% of the country's hard currency profits. By 1952, 95% of Israel's olive groves from seized Palestinian lands. Olive produce from stolen Palestinian groves represented the third largest export after citrus and diamonds. One-third of all stone production from 52 seized Palestinian quarries. Now, you know the mythology. Zionist industry, Zionist dedication, Zionist skill transformed an otherwise barren desert neglected by its primitive nomadic Arab inhabitants only recently descended from the trees. They made the desert bloom. Yes. Palestinian orchards, Palestinian industry, Palestinian rolling stock factories, houses and possessions pillared after slaughtering conquest. Because this ship of state is a vessel of pirates and its proper flag is a skull and crossbones. The Israeli state is a state based on plunder, based on dispossession, based on ethnic cleansing, based upon massacre. It is predicated upon laws that deny the Palestinians the right to subsist, to work, to live, to utilize the land. They are a people perpetually under siege. They are marked for expulsion. They are marked for removal from one end of Palestine to the next. Some 70 years ago, an orator responded not to the occupation of his country or the liquidation of three-fourths of its towns and villages. He was not reacting to massacre and mass imprisonment and detention camps and torture. He did not decry the systematic seizure of the land and property of an entire people in their overnight transformation into pauperized refugees, existing in tent camps, hunted and persecuted wherever they fled. He did not denounce a 60-year ordeal punctuated by unrelenting bombing and invasion and yet further dispersal. He responded to but a few weeks of sporadic bombing as he declaimed memorably, "I have nothing to offer you but blood, tears, and sweat. You ask, what is our policy? I say it is to wage war by sea, by land, and air with all our might and with all the strength that God can give us to wage war against a monstrous tyranny never surpassed in the dark, lamentable catalog of human crime. That is our policy. You ask, what is our aim? I say in one word, victory. Victory at all costs. Victory in spite of all terror. Victory, however long and hard the road may be. For without victory for us, there is no survival. Let that be realized. No survival. I feel sure that our cause will not be subject to failure. And I feel entitled to claim the aid of all." And a week later, he declared, "We shall defend this place, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches. We'll fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields. We shall fight in the streets. We shall fight house to house. We will fight in the hills to which we retreat. We shall never surrender. And even if, which I do not for a moment believe, this island is subjugated and starving, we shall yet carry on the struggle." Now, what is it that makes it possible for the leader of the Raj, the Imperial Raj, Winston Churchill, to utter these sentiments, but renders them illicit for the Palestinian people? Only that inveterate racism, that imperial consciousness, that denies to a victim people, the world's soldiers for justice, the right to defend their survival, to defend their existence, to fight for their land, to fight for their self-determination, to fight for their survival. The Palestinian people are engaged in a struggle which is at the center of the resistance to imperialism. They are linked inextricably to the struggle of the oppressed masses of the Arab East. As the great Palestinian poet Hassan Kanani, assassinated by the assassination squads of the Zionists, as have been so many of the Palestinian leaders over the decades, Hassan said, The path to the liberation of Palestine passes through Mecca and Riyadh and Baghdad and Damascus and Kuwait and Cairo and Alexandria. Yes, the struggle of the Palestinian people is a struggle for the liberation of an oppressed populace, of an oppressed region. For Zionism is but the continued instrument of a colonial presence and imperial presence that we see unfolding before our eyes in Iraq and targeting Iran and targeting Syria and targeting but 80 more countries. It is a struggle that speaks to all of us, and we cannot deny to the Palestinian people that elementary right to resist that we reserve for ourselves, because our own oppression and the subjugation that our rulers would impose upon us is in tandem with their visiting upon the people of Palestine and the Arab East their imperial designs, of which the Zionist colonial state is but a locus operandus, the means of enforcement, the inexorable reflection of capitalism and imperialism and of a ruling class in our lives. And that is our obligation and our struggle to speak truth to power and to stand with the Palestinian people in their resistance and their struggle for survival.
You've been listening to The Hidden History of Zionism with Ralph Schoenman. Copies of The Hidden History of Zionism are available in CDs or by the book, Hidden History of Zionism by Ralph Schoenman. Those are available by email at by emailing cic@pacbell.net. That's cic@pacbell.net. Ralph Schoenman can be reached at takingaim@pacbell.net by calling 707-552-9995 or visit his website at www.